So today, I figured I'd do something different than what I've done before and talk about something I actually know about, music, the wonderful world of music. Romans 1:20, for in his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, they've been clearly seen, perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made, so no one's without excuse. It's telling us in Romans that the nature of things declares the glory of God. We don't have to go very far to see God. And when I look at music, I see profound truths of the nature of God. In fact, I'm going to make a bold statement that's me talking. I cannot find a scripture to directly correlate this, but I believe it's a great hypothesis. I think music is God's signature on creation. Literally. Not figuratively, literally. And I'm going to try to give some substance to that. What I'm going to do, I'm going to spend some time first looking at the substance of this thing we call music. Sound, frequencies, harmony, this thing we call music. What is it exactly? Okay? And how does this ring true, this statement I got up on the bulletin board, that declares organization, planning, right? Structure. It declares God. Secondly, I'm going to take about 10 minutes and look at us and what little we know or don't know about how music affects us in some sort of mysterious way. They've studied this. We know in part how it affects our brain, our emotions, how we're connected to that. How deep does that go? And thirdly, I want to look to Scripture, and in light of what we see in part one and two, let the weight of what Scripture says maybe have a more profound, deeper impact on you, having a little deeper understanding as to its nature and to its effect on us. So the first part's going to be a little bit technical, and it's not important that you understand all this. I share it for the purpose that you get a sense. You get a sense that there is real substance to this. Okay? There's a temptation, perhaps, to think of music as some concoction of the human race. Started with some guy in a cave banging on a drum, and it evolved as we evolved for entertainment, because it makes us happy. It is not that. It is so much more. And so I'm going to dive in and attempt. I'm going to have to watch the clock in part one in about 10 minutes to give you the essence of what it is. I'm going to pray first. This is going to be dangerous and hard to share 40 years of learning in 10 minutes. So, Father, help us to appreciate the beauty, the majesty, the glory that is yours in your creation, music. Help us to appreciate it at a new, deeper, and more profound level, to appreciate the importance of it in our lives. Your commands, your admonishments, your instructions in Scripture, and why that is important because of the way it affects us. For your name's sake, amen. So, is this hooked up? Crash course, here we go. Lock and load. That's music. All it is waves, waves of energy. It hits your ears, right? If I speed this up, that's 2 times a second. Doesn't really sound like a pitch, does it? That's 9 times a second. When we get to about 20 times a second or so, it starts to sound a bit like a pitch, doesn't it? If I was to get to 60, so at the simplest, most basic level, what we have is patterns of energy hitting your ears. That's 60. That's the sound of a fluorescent light, alternating current. 60 times a second back and forth creates 60 pulses a second that hits your ears at this frequency, right? A440 on the piano, if I could tap 440 times a second, you would literally hear that. That's all that is pulses of energy. And up it goes until we can't hear it anymore. right? What's special about that? So let's go deeper and then deeper and then deeper and deeper. It's not that simple, because when anything resonates, this is going to get technical. I'm sorry, but I have to do this. You're going to see something. Some of you will get this. When something resonates, it never resonates simply. When a body resonates that has mass and has shape and has elasticity and wants to resonate, it's going to have a favorite, you know, a tube of a certain length. It's going to want to resonate at a certain length, at a certain speed, because of its length and mass and elasticity. It doesn't just simply vibrate. It will vibrate at all multiples of itself, all at once. So the whole tube's vibrating, and it's vibrating in two parts, and in three parts, and in four parts, and in five parts, and in six parts, and in 12 parts, all at once. Okay? This is called an overtone series or a harmonic series. And that's why you've got these, antique trumpets. They've got no valves, and they play different notes. With different energy, we can favor some of the harmonics that are in the tone. Now, this is really important for what I want to show you. And just to illustrate, this may be, you might want to turn my microphone off for a second. Just, it's like a bottle. If I take a bottle and I blow harder, you'll take a little recorder. And you blow too hard, you get the octave up. Because now it's vibrating. You've got enough energy for it to vibrate in two parts. And then if you blow even harder, you can get it to vibrate in three parts. Now, why is this important? How does this relate? Because this has structure. It has amazing structure that's not just in sound. It's in all energy, harmonic structure, right? This is just proof for me of this verse. We did not invent music. It was always there from the beginning of creation. Right? So, if I had a C, a tube, a bottle, a hollow piece of cane in the bushes of Africa, and I blew hard enough, I could get it, the octave, and then I could get the G. That's it vibrating in three parts. Oh, a new note. Let's make another xylophone for that note. They go together, they blend together, one grows out of the other one. Okay, let's make a tube for the G, an overblow. The first new note I'll get is a D. Let's do the same with the D, I'll get an A. Do the same with the A, I'll get an E. Now I've got the pentatonic scale. And that's why it's built that way. It has structure, it has design. If I go to Africa or India or China or North American Indians or anywhere in the world where music was developed independent without communications, they all have stuff in common. Those first five harmonics, okay, are common to all cultures. And you can play so much music on just those five notes. It all works because they blend together, because they grow out of each other. The black notes on the piano is those five notes. There's five black notes, and you can play them in any combination, in any rhythm at all. Always works. Literally. Not figuratively. Literally. It's beautiful. And this came out, If I start on a different note, it sounds like a different culture. This is an African xylophone would be tuned to those five harmonics, 32-note xylophone, and you get that African blues scale. Any combination, any rhythm. Amazing Grace. It's probably actually an African tune that came out of the hold of a slave ship, right? Those five notes. Just black notes. Okay? Pretty profound, but it gets better, a lot better. If we keep on going up the harmonic series, the notes we get, and I could do this, I had a guitar here, but should I do this? I put it away. There's Esther's guitar. She'll forgive me. She has to. if I play half the string, I get the octave, right? The fifth. We can start experimenting with tubes, and cultures can start experimenting with tube lengths and string lengths, and what they'll find, and what you find in the piano, is when you play a note, you're actually hearing a symphony of notes. It's never one note. I'm going to show you a little video so you actually can hear it and see it for yourself. And the reason instruments sound different is because those harmonics are in different distribution. A clarinet's kind of missing every second harmonic, so it sounds more hollow. Saxophone has all the harmonics. A hoboo has more amplification on the higher harmonics. It gives them their color. But all sound has, and here's the beautiful thing. This is where I'm going with it. The harmonic series, starting on a C, is the octave, the fifth, the octave, the third, the fifth, the flat seventh. It's in all sound. That means the major chord is there in every single note you've ever heard. The dominant seventh chord that makes harmony go round is there in every single sound you've ever heard. It's dictated to us by the way it's created. The pentatonic scale, that's the backbone of all musics, is there. It was created that way. We did not create it. Okay? So with that interest in mind, play video. I took like a 20-minute video and I took 3 minutes of it, just so you could see some of the history. And you could hear, she does a demo of actually playing the overtone series, how the tone changes. You're adding notes, but it still sounds like one note. So go for it.
You probably know him from the whole Pythagorean theorem thing, but he's also famous for doing this. He took a string that played some note, let's call it C. Then, since Pythagoras liked simple proportions, he wanted to see what note the string would play if you made it half the length. So he played half the length and found that the note was an octave higher. He thought that was pretty neat. So then he tried the next simplest ratio and played a third of the string. If the full length was C, then a third the length would give the note G, an octave and a fifth above. The next ratio to try was 1/4 of the string, but we can already figure out what note that would be. If half the string was C an octave up, then half of that would be C another octave up, and half of that would be another octave higher, and so on and so forth. And then 1/5 of the string made the note E. But wait, let's play that again. It's a C major chord. Okay, so what about 1/6? We can figure that one out too, using ratios we already know. 1/6 is the same as a half of a third, and 1/3 was this G. So 1/6 is the G an octave up. Check it out. 1/7 will be a new note because 7 is prime, and Pythagoras found that it was this B flat. Then 8 is 2 times 2 times 2, so an eighth gives us C 3 octaves up. But let's make one thing clear. This is not some magic relationship between mathematical ratios and consonant intervals. It's that these notes sound good to our ears because our ears hear them together in every vibration that reaches the cochlea. Every single note has the major chord secretly contained within it. So that's why certain intervals sound consonant and others dissonant, and why tonality is like it is, and why cultures that develop music independently of each other still created similar scales, chords, and tonality. This is called the overtone series, by the way. Now I'll make another at twice the frequency, 440, which is A an octave above. Here it is alone. If we play the two at once, do you think we'll hear the two separate pitches, or will our brain say, hey, two pure frequencies an octave apart? The higher one must be an overtone of the lower one, so we're really hearing one note. Here it is. Let's have the next overtone. 3 times 220 gives us 660. Here they are all at once. It sounds like a different instrument from the fundamental sine wave, but the same pitch. Let's add 880, and now 1000. That sounds wrong. All right, 880 plus 220 is 1100. There, that's better. We can keep going, and now we have all these happy overtones. So there you have it. These notes given to us by simple ratios of strings, by the laws of physics and how frequencies vibrate in sympathy with each other, by the mathematics of how sine waves add up. These notes are hidden in every spoken word, tucked away in every sigh. You hear them in birdsong, bees buzzing, car horns, crickets, cries of infants, and most of the time you don't even realize they're there. There is a symphony contained in the screeching of a halting train, if only we were open to listening to it.
Interesting, eh? Yeah, you can stop it. That's starting again automatically for some reason. Kind of cool, eh? Music was created before the foundation of the world, right? There's evidence, for example, that Satan himself was a musical being before creation. We're not going to go there in depth, but it always was. But this gets more profound. Because this harmonic series that I'm talking about, that is the essence of music, it's all there. The entire chromatic scale, the pentatonic scale, the major chord, the dominant seventh chord that makes harmony work, it's built into the fabric of sound. All wave forms have this pattern. All energy has, radio waves have this pattern. The pattern of harmony, what we call harmony, the pattern that we call music, is in radio waves, ultra waves, light waves, gamma radiation, the energy signature of the fabric of the universe. I remember watching a movie once. It's a fictional movie called Contact, and they've got some alien signal. And in the movie, they've got this guy listening, and he's saying, I thought it was noise, but there's structure here. There's more messages built in the harmonics of the tone. And they start deciphering all this. In radio waves, you've got this harmonic structure. It's not just mechanical waves. It's also an electromagnetic spectrum that this also occurs. Isn't that beautiful? I am astounded the more I study this. This could be a whole weekend seminar. I try to condense this into one thing so you can appreciate this. I really mean it. I feel, and this is me talking, that music is the signature of God on all of creation. Because not just sound, all energy forms have some degree of this signature. And everything is singing at some subatomic level or macro level. Now, in that interest, I got another short video, number two, which is about a 20-minute video. I'm going to move towards more spiritual stuff, but I really want you to grasp the significance of this. This guy gives a weekend seminar, and I've actually taken a 20-some-odd-minute video and condensed it into 3 minutes. And, you know, stars actually sing. Pulsars sing. They vibrate. They oscillate. So this guy kind of cooked this up a little bit, but it is unedited. He takes some pulsars, and he takes some microwave stars, and he mixes all together with whales. And just so you know, put Psalm 148 up. We're going to be turning to scripture a lot more towards the second half of this. Psalm 148. You know, praise the Lord from the heavens, from the heights above. His angels, praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Praise him, sun, moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Is this just poetic? Or is it somewhat literally true? Because we're actually listening to stars now. We spent all this money on radio telescopes. And we're getting stuff back, right? Praise the Lord, all the earth, you great sea creatures and all ocean depths. Now, I'm just impressed with this video, and I just want to leave it with you because, you know, he's making a point. But it is true that the sounds are unedited. He just put them together synchronized. And the song he drops on top of it is unedited. There's music out there among the stars. Play it.
Praise him, sun and moon, and praise him, all you shining stars. That's not just a poetic idea. That's really happening because stars don't just shine. Stars also sing. Let me just show you a couple more stars. This one is called the Vela Pulsar, and it's magnificent. It's shooting a radio frequency out of itself. When they aimed the radio telescopes at the Vela Pulsar, this is what they heard. Now, I don't know about you, but that blew me away. I'm thinking, wow, this is incredible. You're like, well, what does it mean? A radio signal into the universe that would join in the symphony of God's praise from all creation. There are 12 of these super giant blue stars in there, but the things that are of interest to us tonight are these millisecond pulsars are making this sound right now. Beautiful. Who knew? No, God has his own string section. He's only rotating 1.5 times per second, which is not all that much, but we need him in our little experiment we're going to do here, okay? And so we're going to put the millisecond guys in there.
We
stars. And then 16 others, it's the whales, and we got something going. But I was asking what you're asking, because some people need it really clear. Like, what are they singing? And we tried this, and you just gotta know this is unedited. We just dropped this on, and this is what happened. This is what they might be singing. You wanna sing along with Stars and Whales?
I don't know about you, but that impresses me. So the emphasis, you know, this is such a big thing, and I've gone fast, and I know it's technical, I'm sorry, but I want to impress upon you that there's substance to the statement that the music is God's signature, that there's design and structure in it, that's a gift of God to the human race, and it's in everything. It's amazing, right? And even the stars are singing his praises in a way. It's I love it. So part two, let's move on. Us. Human beings. I'm going to talk about how music now affects us. And I'm going to start this by telling a few stories. Because I used to think, you know, musical therapy is a bunch of hocus pocus. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't, I don't know. But I got a couple stories that really put that in doubt. And then I'm going to show another short video that can, in 3 minutes, tell you everything I want you to know a lot quicker than me talking for another 20. First of all, music is embedded in the signature of energy and creation. Secondly, I want to propose that music reaches us at a profoundly deep, deep, deep level that we are only beginning to understand a little bit. Now, a couple stories and then the video. I used to do performances for HASO, Health Arts Ontario, now Concerts in Care. And the first one I ever played, we went to the retirement home, and after we finished our set, guitar and clarinet, they asked, will you come up to the lockdown floor and play for the people that are locked down for their own safety? And they're in various states of dementia. So we're going from room to room. I went into this one room, there was this guy staring out the window like blank. He's gone. It was obvious. And I would think it was playing Stranger on the Shore. And he started singing along. And the nurse started crying. When we left the room, I was like, what? She says, I've been here 3 years, and he has never made a sound. Music reaches us at a very deep level. We should get, when we go and we read the verses, it commands us to sing. You know? It should have deep meaning. Another story, just to drive home that there's something special about music and the way it interacts with our brain and our emotions. There's something special that's unique, okay? There's this gentleman that's now no longer with us, Dave Hildinger. He was a teacher at Ottawa U, a fabulous world-class musician, composer, spent much of his life in Germany working for Dutch Gramophone. Many of Ottawa musicians were helped by him and trained by him. So later in life, he gets dementia. He doesn't recognize his wife anymore. He's withdrawn with himself, not communicating, doesn't recognize anybody, doesn't talk anymore. He gets sick. He's in hospice. He's going to die. And a few musicians decided, we should go play for Dave's birthday. It's the last chance we're ever going to get to see him again. We should do this. So three musicians that were trained by him and in his ensembles and worked with him, go to the hospice, they wheel him out. He got out of his chair and somehow made it to the piano and started playing with them. Not struggling, just like he used to. Tune after tune after tune after tune, he played a set. Then he withdrew within himself and disappeared, never to be heard from again, and died shortly thereafter. I think of Peter Smith, my first clarinet teacher. He had a stroke. He never came out of it. He died while he was in the hospital. The day before he died, some friends of mine had gone to see him. And they said he was gone, but he was sitting there fingering the Mozart clarinet concerto. He was the second clarinet player in the National Arts Center. He spent his life in it. So my message is, you know, what we're exposed to is important, right? Whatever, and the Bible agrees with this, whatever is pure, whatever is wholesome, you know, dwell on these things, right? I'm not looking at my notes at all. I should do this. We got some scripture coming on. You know, it's important what we dwell on, what we feed ourselves with. And music, we have a special relationship with that. That does things. They're beginning to study this. They've never been able to study it before. But they're finding when people read, they can do live scans. A certain part of the brain lights up. And when people do motor skills, a certain part lights up. And when people listen to music, the whole thing lights up. When they perform music, it's like fireworks. If they're improvising and creating, it's like a bright light bulb. It's not like other arts, and it's not like anything else they've studied at all. They've done tons of studies that children that study music for an extended period of time, 3 years or more, actually end up functioning better. It develops their brain. And all I'm saying is there's evidence. And we should take the scripture seriously when it says to sing his praises, to sing psalms and hymns. It does something to us. It's not for fun. It actually impacts our emotions and physically impacts our brains. Listen to this video. And then we're going to go to scripture after this. And hopefully, in light of these things, these verses will take on more weight.
Neuroscientists have made enormous breakthroughs in understanding how our brains work by monitoring them in real time with instruments like fMRI and PET scanners. When people are hooked up to these machines, tasks such as reading or doing math problems each have corresponding areas of the brain where activity can be observed. But when researchers got the participants to listen to music, they saw fireworks. Multiple areas of their brains were lighting up at once. But when scientists turn from observing the brains of music listeners to those of musicians, the little backyard fireworks became a jubilee. It turns out that while listening to music engages the brain in some pretty interesting activities, playing music is the brain's equivalent of a full body workout. The neuroscientists saw multiple areas of the brain light up, simultaneously processing different information in intricate, interrelated, and astonishingly fast sequences. Playing a musical instrument engages practically every area of the brain at once. The most obvious difference between listening to music and playing it is that the latter requires fine motor skills, which are controlled in both hemispheres of the brain. It also combines the linguistic and mathematical precision in which the left hemisphere is more involved with the novel and creative content that the right excels in. For these reasons, playing music has been found to increase the volume and activity in the brain's corpus callosum, the bridge between the two hemispheres, allowing messages to get across the brain faster and through more diverse routes. This may allow musicians to solve problems more effectively and creatively in both academic and social settings. Because making music also involves crafting and understanding its emotional content and message, musicians often have higher levels of executive function, a category of interlinked tasks that includes planning, strategizing, and attention to detail, and requires simultaneous analysis of both cognitive and emotional aspects. This ability also has an impact on how our memory systems work. And indeed, musicians exhibit enhanced memory functions, creating, storing, and retrieving memories more quickly and efficiently. Studies have found that musicians appear to use their highly connected brains to give each memory multiple tags, such as a conceptual tag, an emotional tag, an audio tag, and a contextual tag, like a good internet search engine. So far, they have found that the artistic and aesthetic aspects of learning to play a musical instrument are different from any other activity studied, including other arts. And several randomized studies of participants who showed the same levels of cognitive function and neural processing at the start found that those who were exposed to a period of music learning showed enhancement in multiple brain areas compared to the others. This recent research about the mental benefits of playing music has advanced our understanding of mental function, revealing the inner rhythms and complex interplay that make up the amazing orchestra of our brain.
You know, I don't pretend to understand this at all, but we know, you know, I give the examples at the beginning. Whatever it does, it goes deep, real deep, right? And the Bible is consistent about having us focus on the things of God, on the things above, whatever is, you know, praiseworthy, whatever is good. You combine that with music, and the imprint, what we imprint ourselves with is very, very important. What we expose ourselves to is very, very important. So let's go. I'm going to look at some verses, a couple that I don't have slides for. You know, in light of its God's signature in creation, it's this powerful thing that impermeates everything. In light of how it impacts us, you know, I think that the music is really a window into the soul and the perfect vehicle to express ourselves and connect spiritually. Here's a couple interesting verses, and then I have a whole pile to put up on the screen. We'll get there real soon. 2 Kings 3, I find this interesting, and I added these at the end of the study last night. You know, Elisha asked God, some men asked him, this prophet, something on their behalf. And Elisha responded, "Bring me a musician." And when the musician played, the hand of God came upon him. I don't know. There's some connectivity there that's interesting, isn't it? We can go to the story of Saul. I was going to add that too. It wasn't in the original message here, where David plays for Saul, and Saul has an evil spirit, and it leaves him, relieves him when David plays. There seems to be a spiritual connection, power, encouragement. There's something I don't understand about what goes on when we're connected to music. Let's go to my slides and just read a bunch of verses. And my hope was, knowing these things, these verses will resonate more. I need to address one last thing. You know, when it says musicians, the voice is an instrument. So you count. And just in case anyone thinks, hey, I don't count because I'm tone deaf. A lot of people think they're tone deaf. Nobody's tone deaf. You all have a fantastic ear, right? If you were tone deaf, you couldn't tell the difference between someone from Manchester and someone from Texas, the tone. The phone rings, you answer it. You not only know it's your mother, you know what mood she's in. Right? You've got a fantastic ear, right? Maybe we need to exercise the mind a little bit. Maybe we need to exercise the muscle a little bit. But you all got ears. Slides. You got the order there. Just go ahead and put them up one at a time. I find this really fascinating. One of the minor prophets. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing. I'd never noticed this before. When I was doing the study, I learned this. Is this an image of God singing over us? I've always thought of us singing. I think of angels singing. I think of the seraphim singing. I never really thought about God singing. Next slide. Old Testament admonishments to sing. You know, I thought I was going to get this comprehensive list of verses that kind of command or encourage us to sing, and you can Google search it yourself, but you know, 228 verses saying, sing! You know, he's not really suggesting it either. Right? These are some old, I will sing a new song to you, my God, on the 10-string lyre I will make music to you. This is David in the Psalms. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise, make music to God on our harp. So not just singing, instruments. Let them praise his name with dancing. That's interesting. We're not going to do that today. No. And make music to him with the timbrel and the harp. praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in his mighty heavens, praise him for his acts of power, praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet, praise him with the sound of the harp and the lyre, praise him with the timbrel and dancing, praise him with the string and the pipe, praise him with the clash of cymbals, praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. I find it interesting that God both chose to have his signature of music on all energy forms, including the ones we can hear, and he wants us to engage in singing. Right? He wants us to get on board, to participate. Christianity is a participation activity. It's not an intellectual activity. It's nice to understand, but the bottom line is what you see is what you get. Right? It's not all about this. It's about this. And somehow music reaches this. How? I don't know. I just know it is. It's on the fabric of the essence of the energy that makes our being, and it reaches us deep, deep, deep at some level we don't understand. And look how he goes on and on and on about it throughout Scripture. Next slide. Here we have the host in heaven singing. This is from the Christmas story. A multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying glory to God in the highest, on an earth peace among those with... It's interesting. How many verses can you think of where you have a picture of heaven and there is singing? You know, music is his fingerprint on creation, but it appears to have a prominent place in heaven too. There's Revelation, right? And here I'm going to the bottom of this. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. You know, this is in the midst of tragedy. The seven plagues, the end of the age, and they're singing. But lamentation, it's not all happy days. A lot of the Psalms, David's Psalms, are lamentations, right? Music isn't just happy times. It's also laments. And it's expression of our soul. It's a window into our soul that God has given us, that he asks us to use over and over. Next verse, let's keep going. You know, I had to stop at some point because there's just so many of them. I didn't know what to pick. But go on Google, you know, singing Bible, verses about singing. Oof. There's a study for you. It'll keep you busy for a week. New Testament, let the word of God, Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. So this isn't just heavenly, and it's not just Old Testament. You'll find tons of this in the New Testament too. So we don't sing in church because it's the correct thing to do, simply because of tradition, because it makes people feel good and it'll get them out to church, and we should sing songs and more people will come. God commands us to sing. And there's a role for music in our lives, in my life. There's a role for music in your life. What we imprint ourselves with is important. Right? Let me back up. See if I can find... I've completely just gone improvising here. Philippians 4:8. I should read it because it really relates to this. Whatever... Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praisey, think about such things. What does Romans say in 12? I love this verse. It's my go-to place for knowing the will of God and becoming more like him and the whole mission. Because in Romans, which we went through once together, from the beginning to the end of chapter 11 is all this theory, doctrine, explaining problems, negotiating the truths, principles. And then in verse 12 to the end, he's okay, now here's how you're going to live. Here's how we're going to apply it. So it's like fresh start. The first thing he says, this is therefore, I'm trusting my memory here. This is dangerous. Therefore, be not conformed to this world, right? He says, to be conformed to the image of Christ by the renewing of our minds. What we put in here, so that we can test and discern the will of God. We're to conform to his image. How? By renewing our minds. Why? So we can discern better. The message really is what goes in here, the way we think is important. And this is not a spiritual concept. This is a plain truth that anyone that's studied advertising knows. What you're exposed to matters a lot. I still sing these stupid little commercials to myself that I heard in 1968 listening to Gilligan's Island or some stupid little sitcom. They imprint.
They do.
They imprint deep, right? So if what we listen to is important, and if music is a vehicle that's a window into the soul, and if it's of God, created by God, and it's a signature on creation, and if he tells us whatever it is, 250 some odd times in scripture, sing. Sing. Play instruments. Sing. Sing his praises. And it's not restricted to that. You can follow the example of David too in his Lamentations. And when you're struggling and having, you know, I've been in debates with people before where, you know, song has to always happy, right? I'm going to read a little bit of Psalm 69 for the director of music. You know, happy verses? You know, save me, O God, from the waters that have come up to my neck. I sink in the myriad depths where there is no footholds. I've come to the deep waters. The floods engulf me. I'm worn out, calling for help. My throat is parched. My eyes fail, looking for God. Those who hate me without reason outnumber the hairs on my head. There are, and on it goes. It's like, oh, wow. I'd really like to hear the melody to that. But here is David using this gift of music as an expression of the soul, right? And I can't explain it. It's intangible. But it's a gift, and it's part of what makes us human. You know, so much of life is consumed by providing for our needs and fulfilling the obligations of our choices. For what? So we can survive? What makes us human is not these things. What makes us human is the intangibles. Faith, hope, love. Things that defy quantization. And music's one of those things. All this kind of defies quantization. It's kind of this mysterious gift of God. His signature on creation, his window into our soul, a means to express ourselves like no other means. I've spent my entire life chasing this thing we call music, holding that piece of metal or that other piece of wood forever. And I'm just starting to understand, just beginning to grasp a little bit of how important it is. Let us sing his praises. So, challenge, something to do. Don't wait for church next Sunday to sing. And if you don't want to sing in public, you know what my favorite place is? The car. I tune pianos. I'm in the car all day long. So, to conclude, I'd like to pray, but first, could we sing this together? A cappella? I'm going to embarrass myself now. You know this.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
One more time, up a tone, and a little more free with the time. It sounds so good. I've always been impressed by the singing here, because you guys do sing. The Grace Choir. So I may do this. Stop, wait for it. It's an expressive thing. Never put a musician up front. Here we go.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
That's what I've been singing in the car the most of the week. Imprint yourself with this stuff. It's God's order, His command for your life. Don't just sing on Sunday, sing every day. It'll do wonders for your soul. Father, thank you for the gift of music, for the signature on creation, for the design and beauty of it. And thank you for the way it affects us in our emotions, in our brain, in our physique, and on some level that we don't really understand. But help us, remind us to embrace this gift in the way that you command us in Scripture over and over and over and over and over again, to sing your praises, to do it often. Amen.